Okay, let's get started. Today, we will have an introductory lecture on normalizing flows. It's another type of generative model. You probably have already learned variational autoencoders yesterday, yes, and generative adversarial networks today. Yeah? Did you learn them? Yeah? Raise your hands. Okay, cool. Okay, this lecture is more kind of probabilistic approach to generative modeling. So, and probably you can already answer the question, what is generative model? Can you give me any definition of that? Yeah. Somebody? Yeah. Effectively, we just trying to learn a distribution of our data. That's it. It's no better definition of generative modeling because we have a lot of examples and they're very, very different from each other. But effectively, we are learning distribution of our data. And that's it. I can give you some example. We can have some data points, okay? And yeah, in this case, these data points are just vectors of size 2, and that's it. It's kind of fairly simple data distribution, just in two dimensions. That's it. And our goal is to learn a model, a probability density function that approximates our data distribution. So all these points come from this true data distribution, and we have no access to this true probability density function. And effectively, we want to learn a model to approximate this probability density function. And probably, in this case, you can guess what would be a reasonable model for this data. Any ideas? Yeah, say it. Like Gaussian, yeah. And in this case, Gaussian distribution is very reasonable because, you know, we kind of can plot these ellipses with Gaussian distributions. It's just a normal distribution, maybe with diagonal covariance matrix, maybe with full, doesn't matter for now. Yeah, and it's kind of super, super reasonable in this case. Yeah. If everyone agrees with me or not, yeah. Okay. But, okay, it's not always the case. We cannot always approximate any complex data with Gaussian distribution, you know. Sometimes we can have, sometimes we can have a kind of more complex data. And can you guess if the Gaussian distribution is the right fit for now? Why? Louder. Yeah, it does not look as a Gaussian at all. Yeah, really. And if we try to fit our Gaussian distribution for this data, we will obtain something like that. Just imagine that we start sampling some points from this distribution. And yeah, we will not obtain our samples from our target distribution at all. Yeah, in this case, Gaussian distribution is a completely wrong. We kind of have a situation where our model is not expressive enough to fit a data distribution. Yeah, it could be a lot of different ways from this point, so we kind of can have a mixture of Gaussians and kind of approximate this distribution with a big, big mixture of Gaussian distributions, and it will also work for now. But you know, it's also not a very complex distribution. It's just two-dimensional distribution, and that's it. Yeah, and why do we even care? Okay, why do we need these generative models? The problem is that in real life, this two-dimensional distribution, this two-dimensional space, might be not a two-dimensional space. It might be almost 50k dimensional space. And our objects, it's not just two-dimensional points here. They might be some pictures, some RGB pictures with a kind of big, pretty big size. Yeah, and in this case, if you try to learn mixture of Gaussian or Gaussian model for this data, you will completely have situation like that. So your data distribution is much, much more complex than your model can fit. Yeah, that's it. And why do we need generative models? Any ideas? I have several mine, but if you have any thoughts, you can share it with us. Sorry? Published papers. Published papers, yeah, it's a great point. Any more? Sorry? Extend data sets, yeah, exactly. It's a good point again. Any more? Louder? Sorry? Yeah? Yeah, why not? Yeah, there are a lot of reasons for what can we learn generative models. So it could be data augmentation. So kind of the main purpose is generating new samples. It's kind of extending data set. Like we want to get our data distribution and generate new samples. Yeah, and it's kind of very reasonable. Also, we might want to generate data that are not real data, but it is possible to learn model on them. Let's imagine you have some users, you have data of these users, but you cannot take this data and bring it to some third-party company. But you want this company to train some model for you. So you might learn generative models, generate data of new users, and then just take this fake data generated by generative model and make everything you want with it. So it's kind of generating private training data in this case. Also, there are a lot of applications where we need real samples. Like if you want to convert some text to speech, if you want to do some translation, stuff like that, all of these applications are some kind of generative models in real life. And probably you are using it every day, yeah, literally. Okay, we not can just generate samples, I can remind you. We also have a probability density function here. Like in generative adversarial networks, we do not have one. But here, we have probability density function. So we can also use it for some applications, like imagine you have a data set and you want to detect some anomalies in it, like if you trained your model to predict answers for a missed data set, it is not very reasonable to apply this model to much complex data. And for example, if you want to detect objects where you cannot make a prediction that lies out of your training distribution, you might calculate probability density function at this object. And then if it's kind of too low, if this object has a too low probability, you can just refuse to predict something for it. It's kind of detection out of domain data. And also, a lot of applications are connected with representation learning when we aim to learn some more compact and, from some sense, better representation for our images or for our data, whatever data you have. Sorry. That's it. There are a lot of applications. I definitely cannot cover all of them, but it's very helpful. It's very helpful for both machine learning technologies, like data augmentation and stuff like that, like learning representation, and business as well. So So there are a lot of companies who are working on advanced generative modeling and applying it to real world. Okay. I hope that I convinced you that it is kind of helpful. Okay. And okay, how would we train our generative model? We already have a model. Let's say we start with data set, and data set of independently sampled objects from a true data distribution, okay? Is it clear? Okay. And then we define our model. In this case, we choose parametric models. It basically means that we have some set of parameters, and we want to tune these parameters to make this distribution match this distribution, okay, kind of as close as possible inside our model family. Okay, and what should we assume here? We assume that the model suitable for gradient-based optimization. It basically means that you can take a gradient and can perform optimization with any, your favorite gradient-based optimization method. And not seems working. Yeah. Also, this model should satisfy kind of probability constraints, like it always should give us something positive, and these things should be summed up to one, marginalized to one. And yeah, and we also want to have a kind of sampling procedure that allows us to sample from this distribution just to generate new samples. Okay, and how would we learn this model? You already have learned some model, some methods to learning model like that, probably yesterday. We have data, we have model, what should we do next? Inference, exactly, how? Sorry? Variational inference? Yeah, say it just louder. Bayesian inference is great, but what do you mean by Bayesian inference? Okay, what would we do with likelihood? Okay. We do not care about prior right now, because we have a kind of probability density function. What is the simplest way to learn this model, to tune these parameters? The simplest. Maximize the likelihood. Yeah, exactly. You were saying exactly the same thing, probably. Yeah, we will have a prior just a little bit later. But for now, we do not have one, OK? Because we do not have any kind of latent variables right now. We do not have any prior distribution for our latent variables. It's just a model of our target distribution. And we can just, that's it. We can just take a likelihood. Yeah, probably this point is better. Okay, we have our data set right here. And because all of these objects are IID objects, we can have logarithm of big products with respect to all objects. It's kind of converts to sum of logarithms of every object. And we want to maximize this likelihood by parameters theta. So it's kind of super simple method. Like we informally, we just calculate the probability, very informally, but we calculate the probability or density in every single object, and we want this density to be as high as possible for all training data. It's not super strict, mathematically speaking, but informally, we are basically maximizing probability of our data. Informally, again. And we can solve this optimization problem by any method like stochastic gradient ascent or maybe Adam-like methods, stuff like that. Ascent because we are kind of maximizing this thing, not minimizing. You can do gradient descent, but you need to plug minus here. Yeah, and that's it. It's very simple. I hope that everybody gets it. Yeah? Yeah? Yeah. Okay. It's cool. Talk to me. So if you have any questions, if anything is not clear for you, just raise your hand and ask. It probably will help for all audience. Okay. I'll give you some example of this method. Like we have a data set, it's our two-dimensional data set. We already knew that it's kind of simple. And we already knew that maybe Gaussian model is a good fit for this data set. Like we have a model of probability, which is Gaussian, so no latent variables for now. This Gaussian has two parameters, two set of parameters. It's vector mu and matrix in covariance matrix. So it's basically expectation of this distribution, and this is covariance. Both these parameters can be defined by one parameter vector theta. Okay, so it's just a redefinition. So we have this kind of model. And we are basically calculating this thing, which is log likelihood, and we maximize it. Okay, with respect to mu and covariance matrix. Okay, sigma. Super simple. Yeah, and I just kind of ran some gradient-based optimization methods and obtained solution. And solution is like, we have centered two here, centered two here. We have some covariance. And yeah, we have some variances of these different dimensions. Yeah, that's it. Kind of super simple example. And the funny thing is that it is also possible to fit much, much more complex data with this approach. So it's some kind of very simple example and very basic stuff, but it's kind of very well, it will scale very well in just several minutes, I guess. Okay, how to choose model for complex data? Okay, one example is variational autoencoders. So, because this method, normalizing flow, is very, very similar to variation autoencoders, I probably should draw a connection. So this is a connection. And what is variation autoencoder? Let's suppose our objects for now are images. And we have an image, we encode them into latent space with encoder network. And then we decode them. So it's kind of a process of obtaining latent representation with given object. And if we want to sample new object in this model, we have a prior distribution right here. And what sampling process is looks like? We assemble some vector z from this prior distribution, okay? Just sample some vector, yeah, from our prior, then plug it into decoder network because this scene is conditioned on z. It is conditioned on our sample. And then we can obtain a sample from our model. Effectively, if we write down distribution over axis that is defined by this model, we should marginalize out our latent variable. Basically, what I'm saying is that if you write down logarithm of p of x defined by this model, you have to integrate your decoder network with respect to samples from prior distribution. You kind of, if you want to sample from this distribution, you sample something from prior, plug it in here, you obtain a sample. But if you want to obtain a whole distribution, you kind of have to integrate. And what is the problem here? First of all, why do we even care about calculating these? Okay, maybe we will do anomaly detection. But here, under logarithm, we have an expectation. And if we unbiasedly estimate this expectation, like we take several samples from our prior distribution, plug it in here, average the predictions, and then apply a logarithm, we will not and obtain an unbiased estimate of this thing. It's almost impossible to estimate this kind of scene very precisely. So the idea here is that we cannot perform an unbiased estimate of our log of x. log p of x, sorry. Yeah, and yeah, we cannot calculate it. And it's bad, of course. Next, when we train this model, we use some kind of variational inference. And why do we do that? Because, you know, we cannot perform an unbiased estimate for likelihood, and we should somehow optimize it. So the idea that we exploit in variational inference is, like, let's bound this scene with variational lower bound. And instead maximizing our likelihood, let's maximize our variational lower bound. Without much details, variational inference is simple like that. And it's also bad because instead of maximizing the good objective, we are maximizing some surrogate objective. And surrogate objective kind of not guarantee you that you will maximize your target objective in the end. So they may have different optimum points. They may lead us to different solutions. Maybe it's a good point to ask some questions, if you wish. I'm very encouraging in it, because I want all of you understand this stuff. It's kind of very important. Yeah. I mean that the problem is that in variation of encoders, our blue dream is to maximize true likelihood. But we cannot do it. And instead maximizing true objective, we are performing optimization of lower bound of this objective. Like we have a true objective, we have a lower bound, and we're trying to maximize the lower bound. But the optimum titas may not be the same because of many reasons. So we will probably obtain not as good solution as we can do by optimizing this scene, because it is statistically proven to be good objective function. But yeah, in variation of the encoders, we cannot optimize it. And so we perform different tricks to optimize it, like optimize variational lower bound. Yeah, it's kind of lower bound on our objective, and if we maximize it, yeah, it will maximize this scene. But probably it may not maximize it so well. Okay. And so the question is, can we obtain a model that is expressive? Oh, yeah, sure.
Sorry. So can you go again briefly on why exactly we cannot get an unbiased estimate of P of X over there?
Oh, okay, sure. Okay, here we have an expectation. It's kind of big sum. And it's well-known fact in statistics that if you take an estimate, an unbiased estimate of this expectation, and then apply nonlinear function to it, then you will not obtain an unbiased estimate. That's it. Okay, yeah. Yeah, because always we are interested in logarithm, because we cannot do optimization of product of a lot of numbers in our kind of ordinary PCs. Yeah, so we always worry about logarithm in a lot of cases. Yeah, and yeah. A little bit spoiler alert here. But yeah, can we define function that has a tractable probability density function? And yeah, it probably should be based on CNN somehow. And yeah, is it possible? Is it even possible to do just make some expressive probability density function that is suitable for optimization and blah, 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 blah. And yes, answer is yes, and answer is normalizing flow. So it's topic of our lecture today. I know introductory part was kind of long, but it's kind of very important to make all of you understand kind of simple basics. Yeah, and then we will discuss normalizing flows. So it's kind of expressive model, like tractable for computation density, for optimization, and we can even perform fast sampling in it. So it's kind of very good model, and we will discuss it for now. And to do that, we need just one piece of math. It's very important to make sure that all of you understand it, and it's kind of really simple. So we'll start with some very simple example, which is just one-dimensional case. We have a P of Z, which is kind of distribution of some random variable. And Z is one-dimensional random variable. So, and this is probability density function. And we have this equation for Z, that Z is a function of X. Okay? And the question I'm asking is, what is P of X? Can we just take these facts and calculate P of X? And of course, answer is yes. It is changing variable formula. You probably learn it in some calculus course, I guess, but let me just remind you. First of all, under changing variable formula, probability mass on infinity small interval should be the same. It has a very nice interpretation in terms of volumes. I'll give you this interpretation in a minute. Okay, just believe me. And if we want to find X from here, we can just plug this in here and obtain a distribution of X. Yeah, that's it. And yeah, this formula does not depend on X, but we know that the Z is a function of X. So we plug it in just here, okay? Very simple, and obtain the final formula. So, yeah, if we want to calculate P of X, we should convert this X to Z, calculate probability of our prior distribution, and account for changing in volume. I give you an example. Okay, let's say we have this distribution over Z. This is a uniform distribution between 0 and 1, so it's support of our distribution, and this is probability of our distribution, okay? So again, very simple. And we have a following connections with X. So X is a 2Z plus 1, okay? And Z is a reverse function for it. Just X minus 1 divided by 2. Okay, it's very simple. Okay, and it's not seems working. Yeah, that's it. We have P of X. Okay, and I need your help. Okay, we have zero point here, and in which point will it go if we just take a zero point here and try to map it to X? One. Okay, are you sure? Yeah, one. Okay, and if you take one, it will go to what? Three. Okay, definitely, it's great. Exactly, yeah. We have a following mapping. And the question I'm asking, what is P of X right here? Just intuitively, without equation. But you can use it if you wish. Sorry? Not exactly. One half, yeah. Because you see, you have a shift that does not affect this probability. So what actually happens? We take this volume, we support between 0 and half, and map it to bigger support. It definitely means that our probability, if you map this volume, should go down. And it should go down by just this factor of 2. We just divide our probability here with factor of 2. Because we take this volume and kind of stack it together. Yeah. Is it clear? And OK, let's try to understand our equation now. The thing is that probability of that thing is 1 everywhere. So if we try to calculate probability of X by this formula, it will not affect anything because it's one everywhere, okay? Then, let's calculate this derivative. And this derivative is just the derivative f of x. This thing is f of x, because z is f of x. And this is 0.5, okay? And then we plug it into formula, and we obtain 0.5. So we have kind of two methods. One is intuitive. We should think about changing the volume. And this equation, which effectively says us how this volume will be changed. So we have this term, which affects changing in volume. And we have this prior probability. Okay, and this is one-dimensional case. We are not... okay, if you have any questions for now, just ask. If it's not clear, we definitely have some time. So it's kind of very simple idea. We kind of have a prior distribution. We have a connection of our latent variable z with our target variable x. And we just answer the question, what is distribution of p of x if we know this transformation and if we know our prior distribution? So it's like a kind of super simple thing. And this is just derivative. I am pretty sure that everybody here are familiar with derivative. OK. Ambiguous? Okay. I'm not exactly understood you. Okay.
No, the function you introduced is a single linear function. So I do understand how to map
Okay, I get your question.
Even if it was x power 2...
Okay, definitely we have some constraints for this function. I did not tell you, but this function should be a bijective function at our support. Yeah, definitely. You're absolutely right. Like, we cannot apply x square function, for example, on the whole support. But if it's reversible for some part of its support, it is okay. So what happens if we apply this thing? We are interested in multidimensional spaces, okay? And what happens if we apply it to n-dimensional case? We exactly have the very same formula, but here we will have matrix of partial derivatives like Jacobian. Because Jacobian is a kind of changing, it's kind of, let's say it's multidimensional analog of gradient. Okay. It's kind of show you how your function is changed by different variables. If you take a derivative of different components of your vector function by, okay, let me start again. This thing is now is a vector function. So x is multidimensional. X is a vector for now. In the case, f also is a vector function. So it takes an input x and vector x and produces also vector. So it's kind of vector function of vector argument. Okay? And this thing is now a matrix of partial derivatives that is called Jacobian. Every cell of this matrix consists of partial derivatives of its some components f divided, so it's partial derivative by x component of input. So it's ith component of output, and this is ith component of input. So it's just a Jacobian. That's it. Probably it's not kind of super clear for now. It would be better if you ask some question. So it's kind of determinant. Determinant is kind of volume measure for matrices. Yeah, and we have a model here, and we have a Jacobian here. It's very important to understand because you will code it in 30 minutes, I guess. Yeah. Okay. It's kind of very simple, Yeah, we just take a Jacobian, compute its determinant, and that's it. That's changing variable formula for multidimensional case. And now I'll present concept of normalizing flows. We have some pictures. Not. We have some pictures, for example, and it's our X space, okay? And we also have a space of latent variables. It's very important that the dimension of Z is equivalent to dimension of X. So it's kind of the same number of components in both of these vectors. It's not the case on the picture, but it's hard to plot multidimensional Gaussian on 2D. So here we have some normal distribution, multivariate normal distribution, and dimension of vectors from this space is equivalent to dimension of vectors from this space, because we will need bijective function. And then, yeah. We introduce some latent space, and yeah, that's it for now. It's all we need that if these pictures are, let's say, lying in some dimensions of space N, Z is also kind of hidden space where all vectors are lying in dimension N, of size N. Yeah, and that's it. And we will define a some simple distribution in Z space. In that case, it's just a normal distribution. It's kind of fully factorized normal distribution for now. And then we take a point from this space and map it with some function, parametric function, to hidden space. So we just define some function, compute it, and then map to the space Z. Okay? It's kind of super simple. Like, you just take function, map, yeah, and we have it for now. And yeah, and there are several important notes, and the first is that this function should be reversible. So we have to analytically compute reverse function. Yeah. And the idea of normalizing flows is pretty much the same as changing variable formula, because we have a prior distribution in our latent space. So P of Z might be just normal with center at 1 and variance with center at 0 and variance 1, for example. So what is the idea? We kind of take this point, map it here, calculate probability of our prior distribution, and then account for the change in the volume, like in previous slide, okay? It's kind of pretty much the same formula as we had, let's say here. It's pretty much the same. But its application, its application for normalizing flows. Yeah, and it's kind of core point of the lecture. If you do not understand something, it's kind of the best point to ask. We have a mic over there. You can call Andrew, and yeah. Yeah, we have a question here. Two questions, yeah, it's good. Yeah.
Hey.
Hey.
So if Z has the same dimension as X,
yeah,
why can we just not X? Why cannot we just use X as points? Why do we need this transformation?
Again, it's kind of this question back us to normal distribution. Like, we cannot define a complex enough distribution in X space. Like, we can do normal distribution, we can do gamma distribution, or whatever you want, but all of them are pretty simple. But we can define a simple distribution in our auxiliary space of auxiliary variables. Yeah, and then we should ask our complex function, which is pretty complex and pretty big, this is deep neural network, map points from the complex space to simple space. And then we use this changing variable trick just to compute this probability. Yeah, that's it. It's a great question. Thank you.
As far as I understand, f of theta is like a deep neural network. And how could be it invertible? So how we could invert?
Yeah, the it's pretty good question. I'll address it in the next slide. okay. Any more questions? Yeah.
So like you have a like a intractable data set X, and you want to map it to a Z, which can be described by normal distribution. But how could you find out this mapping between X and Z?
Yeah, and this question about my just next slide. Thank you. It's a very good question. Thank you for asking. And yeah, we will find it by just gradient descent. Yeah.
So maybe one more clarification point.
Okay.
So you mentioned that Z should have the same dimension as X.
Yeah.
And why is that? So you treat each pixel individually, and they're going to be then individually represented. So as far as I understand, the bijective function would mean that the domains are the same, or like that the whole domain covers the whole image. But what does it have to do with the dimensionality of the data?
Okay, if I get your question. So the idea is that this function should be revertible. So it is bijection. Yeah, we cannot build the bijection if dimensions are different. Yeah, so it's the whole point. Yeah, yeah. And it's kind of weird, but you will see that it may actually works. Yeah.
The things you're talking about remind me of support vector machine with kernel trick. Aren't you trying to do it for neural networks?
I haven't thought about it like that, to be honest. But we probably can discuss it after lecture. Yeah, it's probably a great question, but I cannot answer it right now. So we have really kind of bounded time. Let's go forward a bit. I hope that all of you more or less understand this scene. What is important for now is that I want all of you to understand that F has a very, very, very strict restrictions. First of all, the size of X should be equal to size of Z. It's first one. The second one, F should be invertible. Like we should be able to reconstruct exact value of X given Z. Okay? And F should be a bijection. So it's kind of the same thing as invertibility, but that's it. And it's very strict restriction. We cannot just take an ordinary deep neural network, yeah, and go forward. It is not possible, OK? So the idea is that we will use a special type of layers for that. And this special type of layers is called coupling layer. It's kind of very simple, and I will explain how it looks like. So the idea is that here we will have an input x, and output y. So two vectors. X is an input, and y is an output. And the idea is that we take first and just copy it. So we just copy first D components of this vector to Y. OK? Just copy. The second transformation is structured as follows. We take all another components of X and multiply it by some. OK, first of all, we now have two functions here, S and T. Both these functions are conditioned on these first D components. OK? So S and T should give us a vector, should take an input of size D and should give an output of size D, but D big minus D small and plus minus one. I do not remember exactly, but yeah, size of this scene should be equal to size of this scene. OK, yeah. And this scene should have an output of this shape. And this scene should have an output of this shape again. Okay. So basically, what we are having here, we have two functions. They may be arbitrarily complex, like anything you want. And we make some scale and shifting based on output of these functions. Okay? So it's kind of, this is element-wise multiplication. This is just element-wise exponent. This is maybe your neural network. And this might be any function you want. So the scheme for this layer is like that. I definitely lost something here, but yeah, we took some part of this vector, copied it here. Yeah, it should be the line here and here. Yeah, copy it here, then took again this part of the vector that we just copied before, pass it to S, pass it to T, exponent and output of X. Yeah, multiply it. Yeah, and add output of t to our result. And then we obtain the y. So the question is this function reversible? Any ideas? Who thinks that, yes, that it is reversible? Raise your hands. Who thinks that, no, it's not possible? Some hands, yeah. So the idea is that if we have an x and want to obtain y, so we just copy these components back, okay? This string is reversible, definitely, without any arguments for now. So what we will do next? We will again compute an output of t, but not from x's, but from y's. Like these components are the same, and if we want to obtain a value of t that we used for the forward pass, we just can compute this t from our first d components of y. Okay? So the idea is like we can compute s and t because we just copied these components. They are the same. Okay? Super simple. And then we have a true value of t, true value of s. They are the same here. And then we just subtract t and just multiply by exponent of reverse. Like we just plug it minus here. This function should be reversible. You can use sigmoid as well. Yeah. This is reversible. OK. Is it clear? So it's vector-to-vector function. We can do forward and backward, and it is reversible. But we need one more thing here, and very important thing. We need this function to have a tractable Jacobian. I will show you why. Okay, we had this slide on normalizing flow concept. And as you can see here, we have a determinant of Jacobian. Of course, we use some logarithms here, and it will be log dead of Jacobian of this function. So this function, this coupling layer, should have a tractable Jacobian. And Jacobian is a matrix of partial derivatives. So Jacobian is like that. So we just write it down. And this is a matrix of which shape? OK, I need you to say me a shape of Jacobian matrix. D by D, big or small d? Big. OK. Does everybody agree? Yeah? OK, cool. And what is some part of Jacobian that corresponds to dy by dx? It's diagonal matrix, yeah, because we do not change anything. That's it. OK, what is derivative of this y1 to yd small by other x's? Zero, yeah. Because no other x's affect these components. So it is zero. Yeah, looks pretty great for now. Yeah, then. Yeah. And then, what is derivative of this scene by this axis? Okay, like, it would be just let me put it here. It's some derivative. Yeah, let me put it here. It's pretty complex stuff, probably. And what is derivative of these components by this axis? It's not a kind of constant, but it's kind of sum of these exponents. Yeah. Yeah, that's it. This is diagonal matrix. And question I want to ask you, do we need to compute these derivatives? Why? Yeah, and determinant of lower triangle matrix is just product of all elements on its diagonal. And that's it. We have a pretty tractable Jacobian, and we can compute Jacobian, and we even do not build this okay, we will not build this matrix, but we can compute Jacobian, and it's pretty much tractable. Okay, now, where we are. We have some good loss function. We understand how to build invertible layers, not networks, but layers for now. And we understand how to compute is log dead Jacobian. So we can now build normalizing flow with just one layer. And yeah, that's it. Probably it's not best thing to do. So the idea is that we cannot combine coupling layers like that. OK, can you say me why is it bad decision? Okay, louder, just anybody. Okay, it's pretty much the obvious that can we copy half of the vector or some part of the vector, this part of the vector, and I just again spoiled something. Yeah, so it's pretty much obvious that we copy some part of the vector, and if we will stack coupling layers, we will not change some part of the vector. And it is bad. It's not super flexible. So the idea is that we will apply permutation here, and that's it. Permutation has a tractable Jacobian, and it is one, because you know it's full rank matrix. Yeah, and it is reversible transformation. So if we permute components of these vectors, we can stack it with some another layer. Yeah. And that is an idea. Like, we will combine coupling layers, these coupling layers, with permutations, and we will obtain multi-layer network for now. That's it. And yeah, that is an idea. Okay, what we have? We have function f that maps objects to Hadamard space, both of these space have the same dimension. We have the function which is combination of coupling layers and permutations. Yeah. And we will optimize this loss function. Yeah. Logarithm of our likelihood. Yeah. And the idea is that this transformation, Jacobian, log dead Jacobian of these transformations can be evaluated as follows. Like, we have a log here, we have a determinant of several matrices, and we can break it into sum of determinant of transformations from these, from F1 to F2, from F2 to Fn, and so on. Yeah. So idea is that we kind of can compute this Jacobian automatically. So if we can compute Jacobian for permutation and for coupling layer, this Jacobian will break into sum of logarithms of determinant between different layers. Yeah, that's it. It's probably not super clear for now, yeah, but it's kind of just simple property of determinant. Like if you have determinant of several matrices, it is the same as determinant of each of them and take a product after that. Okay, that's it. That's normalizing flows. Okay, we have some time, just five or a little bit more minutes. I would go through the same example first. I have very, very limited time. Let's talk it just after lecture. Yeah, we have some inference. We have already trained our normalizing flows. So we have X that is sampled from our data or our model, whatever you wish. And this is data, this is our data. And we can infer hidden components. Okay. F is our normalizing flow. Okay, F just a function that is stacked coupling layers and permutations. And we just take this data set. We already have learned our flow, and we can infer hidden components, just latent variables, just using this function. And it works something like that. So for two-dimensional case. So, and it's very reasonable because we have a Gaussian distribution here. So our flow just trying to convert this complex distribution to Gaussian, and we can calculate a PDF. So if we want to generate samples, we can take samples from Gaussian distribution, and these are samples from our prior distribution, okay? And then we can apply just inverse function to F. Our function is reversible, let's apply it. And we will obtain, we will obtain target distribution here, samples from target distribution here, that's it. That is the whole model. I'll just give you some intuition about how it is working. Like we have a combination of coupling layers. Each coupling layers performs some scale and some shifting. And you can see how these data points changing after applying different coupling layers. So it's kind of converting to the target distribution by shifting and scaling, okay? So it's kind of application of different functions from our flow. Yeah, I'll skip this part for now, this also as well. Yeah, it is applicable for images and some more or less state-of-the-art models for normalizing flows can produce pretty good samples. Yeah, these are the samples from GLOW paper. Yeah, and we can do some interpolations between images, all stuff like we can do in any generative models. It's just some examples. It is not the same architecture as I explained to you for now. It's a much bigger network, and it replaces permutations with invertible convolutions. Yeah, it's not exactly working. With invertible convolutions of one by one, it's a kind of technical detail. Yeah, it's not much harder than just we discussed before. How can we measure quality of our normalizing flow? We can just evaluate a likelihood of test data points. So if we train our model by maximizing likelihood on train data points, we can just calculate likelihood on test data points, and it will be somehow a good measure for quality of our model. Okay, just we will calculate loss function, but on the test points. And of course, we also can sample some points from our model and look if it match distribution of our kind of training images or training data or stuff like that. I'll skip that for now. It's not super important. So there are some results and some data sets. It's also, we do not have kind of a lot of time for it right now. It is also possible to train a conditional normalizing flows. Just don't look at these equations. It's not a big deal, but the thing is like we can generate class-specific images with normalizing flows. Like we can ask if the model can generate a sample of cat, yes, it can, and so on. Yeah, there are also conditional normalizing flows. Yeah. And one important thing that I want to discuss, maybe 5 more minutes, yeah, and we will probably do practical session a little bit faster, but it's application of normalizing flows to variational inference. And it's kind of super interesting application from my point of view. I want to explain. So the idea is, the idea of variational inference is like we have a log p of x, okay? And we have our lower bound. Basically, this log p of x is equal to sum of our lower bound and KL divergence between our variational approximation and our true posterior distribution. This is variational left encoder model, let's say. Yeah, and what this scene is basically saying, that if we will maximize lower bound, we will find the better, as good approximation as we can of our posterior distribution, true posterior distribution, with respect to parameters of our model. Let's see, these are all probability distributions. This is our posterior distribution. And these are all distributions that we can define with our variational family Q. And the goal of variational inference finds the closest distribution inside the family to our target distribution, to our distribution of kind of true posterior. And if we have more complex Q, our variational will work better. Yeah, so the idea is like that if this Q, this variational family Q, is kind of very flexible, it's great for our model. We can perform better. And the idea of this paper, I guess it was by DeepMind, maybe 3 or 4 years ago. Like, we have variational left encoder. We have this distribution here. Let's say that, okay, and this distribution for variational left encoder is just Gaussian. Maybe we can replace this Gaussian distribution, this encoder network, this Q, with variational left encoder. Oh, sorry, with normalizing flow. Yeah. And yeah, the idea is like that we kind of trying to replace our variational approximation with more complex distribution. And potentially our variational left encoder model can produce better samples now. So the idea is that normalizing flows can be applied to variational inference as well. They can be combined. Yeah, and for example, we can use normalizing flow as a complex approximation of our variational distribution, of our variational approximation of true distribution. So this thing can be a normalized flow. If you are interested and it's not super clear for now, we can discuss it after lecture. Yeah, it's slight on some relations to GANs, I'll skip it for now, but both of these models have different strengths, yeah, and kind of different bad properties as well. Yeah, and so they're somehow different. Sometimes normalizing flows or likelihood-based model works better. Sometimes GANs works better than likelihood-based generative models. Yeah, I'll skip it for now. I'm too sad. Yeah, so this is our normalizing flows. We discussed it, just discussed it through the lecture. And if you want to know more on normalizing flows, I suggest you to read these tutorials. They're pretty much great. Yeah, I have listed also a number of kind of must-read papers for normalizing flows. So if you wish to understand this model in depth, you might probably want to read these papers. Yeah, and there are some tutorials on some very advanced normalizing flows that is defined with some differential equations and stuff like that. Yeah, I also pretty much suggest to look at it. Yeah, and yeah, that's it. Thank you for having me.